All my relatives, welcome. And again, my nephew has asked me to explain powwow. What I said in my language is I introduced myself. My Assiniboine name is Eagle Claw, and they also call me Four. So I have two names that I carry. And again, to help my nephew here understand about powwow and some of the protocol and stuff like that, I was offered tobacco to share this with all of you. And I have some questions here. And the first question is, what is powwow? Well, powwow was originally started when the warriors would return from battle, and they would share the story, some of these brave and courageous acts that they did on the battlefield as they ducked and they stayed low and they moved around, and they would share that with the people back at the camp and keep it in time with the heartbeat of our Mother Earth through the drum. And in that, they would let them know that they're very proud, very dignified in what they did, and they brought honor not only to themselves but to their family and to their tribe in this opportunity to protect what is theirs. And so they would do that. And so as they continued to wish to count coup, because it's against our nature to take another human's life, so what they would do is they would tell stories on how they snuck up on the enemy, how they would stay low and sneak around, and they would dance in a serpentine manner, because we believe that if we dance straight at our enemy, they would shoot us. So we had to be kind of hard to hit, hard to shoot at. So we'd dance in a serpentine manner. And when we'd find our enemy, we'd go count coup, and we'd hit them with our coup stick. And so you see in some of the attire, big rocks at the end of a stick, or a knife, or a sharp object, or something like that, as they use, they utilize for acoustic. And so instead of killing their enemy, they would humiliate them with a big bump. The paint was significant because the warriors, they always painted themselves the same way, because that was their identity. And then when the enemy went back to his camp, they would ask him, "Who put that big bump on your head?" They would have to tell him that that guy with the red paint and the black line underneath, that's who did that to me. And in lieu of killing your enemy, you just humiliated him by hitting him on the head or whatever. And so because we felt that as First Nations people, we felt it was against nature's law to actually kill another human being. So we'd count coup in lieu of killing them. And so when we returned from the battle, we'd share the story on how we'd sneak up on our enemy, how we'd count coup, and then some of the stories that were told about you by the enemy was how you acquired these, deeds, this acknowledgement of these brave acts, and they would tell stories about you, and they'd even make songs about how you did these things. And so that was what that's how powwow originated. And it was originally just for the warrior, just for the men. And as time went on, the ladies wanted to participate. So they'd go speak to the elders all the time, and they would ask them, "Can we get involved? Can we participate?" And the elders would turn them down. And then finally, they kept asking the elders. They were really insistent on getting involved in this celebration, that how they saw it. And so finally the elders, they relented, and so they let the women come in. And so the women had their regalia on, they opened up their blankets that they had wrapped around them, and they had this very fine beadwork, and so they participated in that. Then after that occurred, then it became a social gathering where we included the children, we included the old people, and again it became what is now known as powwow, or a celebration of life, eh? And so now we have it has since evolved into a social gathering, but yet with protocol and how we approach the center, how we do things, how we treat one another. It's an opportunity for us to educate our young people on how to be sociable at times like this, how to treat our elders, how to treat our relatives, know who our relatives are. All of these things are a part of powwow. It's a social gathering with a certain protocol that's involved for the sake of the continued existence of our people. So powwow has many different aspects as it relates to understanding the importance of that. And again, also, there's different categories within powwow. They have men's traditional, men's grass, men's chicken, men's fancy feather. All of these things have historical value to the celebration of life. And again, when we present ourselves together like this, and this diversity that exists out there in Indian country, where all these different tribes can come together, that is all respected. And again, some of the teachings by our old people is that we don't go to another place and tell them how to do things, but if we're asked to help, we always try to share with them and supporting them with shared information, shared protocol, how we do things, and it comes together in that way. But powwow is contemporarily a very beautiful experience. It helps us understand how to treat our old people, how to treat women, how to treat children, all these things. And at the same time, we understand that the diversity that exists out there is such that in a white man's world, they call it linear education, where reading, writing, and arithmetic is important to them. In our way of life, we call that abstract teaching, and that's experiential learning, it's hands-on. And in that, powwow has an education in itself to where it helps us understand the importance of responsibility, respect, and humility, and all of these good things of disciplining ourselves to look after our regalia, learn the songs, understand the category that you're dancing in, learn about those things, and then it helps you define who and what you are. You know, the white people, when they heal from the outside in. They go to treatment. They get that healing aspect in a white man's way. But in the Indian world, we heal from the inside out. So in that process, powwow helps us to understand that this expression of dance and keeping in time with the heartbeat of our mother earth is important to us because, again, it helps us let other people know how we feel from the inside, from our heart to the outside, as opposed to our non-Indian relatives healing from the outside in. There's a diversity, there's a difference that exists there. One isn't right, one isn't wrong, it's just different. So there's different avenues to for us to approach this healthy lifestyle. And powwow in our Indian world is one of those avenues that we utilize to help understand the importance of our identity, raising our self-esteem, our self-respect, and understanding our sense of belonging that we have, not only from our own personal family, our own personal tribe, but this diversity of all different tribes coming together in a good way with this commonality of pursuing healthy lifestyles in a good way through coming together and dancing together, listening to drums, listening to songs that are made and created in a good way for the sake of us keeping in time with the heartbeat of our Mother Earth and feeling that healing, taking advantage of the medicine that comes from our Mother Earth. And so they told us to always maintain that connection to our Mother Earth. Like when we do ceremony, when we sun dance, we sleep on the ground. When we do ceremony, we sit on the ground. When we dance, we dance in Sundance with no moccasins to maintain that connection. But that's that medicine that comes from our Mother Earth, and we recognize that, especially at powwow as well. We maintain that connection. So it's things like that that a lot of our people sometimes take for granted, but that's okay as long as we're maintaining that sense of protocol as it originally was intended by our old people, and we're attempting to hang on to that traditional value based on these teachings, and yet we live in a very fast-paced world, so sometimes these things are hard to hang on to. But when we go home to our home fires, we go to our own tribes, we go to our own ceremonies, we make sure that we understand the importance of protocol. We don't we don't have to do anything but die, but we prepare ourselves to get ready for that death. We're not afraid of it. But on the other side, the white man's way, they use that fear to kind of control their people. Us guys, we don't fear. We have no fear. They tell us, Mitakiepi, Brehichiapo, Nitakiepi, Wachiniapelo. My relatives, make yourself strong because your relatives are depending on you. And when they say that, Kogi Pishni, that means don't be afraid. And so the white man seen us sitting there not afraid, and they called us stoic. We're not stoic. We just have no fear because we have a strong belief in this higher power that keeps us strong. And these cultural events help us to maintain that strength by understanding this diversity and this uniqueness that exists in such things as powwow that becomes an enhancement and an enrichment for the sake of the growth of our future, which is represented by our children. So we always take opportunities like this to share with our young people some of these manner in which to be respectful, be understanding who your relatives are, be understanding of the type of dance that they do, and help them learn them things from an experiential position. Some of the superstition that's been incorporated in our way is they say, don't take no pictures, don't record this song. That's not because of superstition, that's because of acknowledging that abstract learning, that experiential teaching. We respect that way by that, because we want them to learn it by doing it, not by getting a recording of it or anything like that. That's why that is existing. But some people have manipulated that for the sake of control to make us afraid. We're not afraid. And so, and stuff like that, this is what it enhances. This is what it brings about, is that strength of that healthy lifestyle, that healing process that goes on, that comes from the drum that represents the heartbeat of our Mother Earth. And so that's kind of what powwow is like. And there's a historical value in understanding the different categories, understanding the different rules that go along. And they're not necessarily rules per se, because we don't do things this way or that way. We do them how we feel from the inside out. And so therefore, you have different styles of dance, fancy dance, grass dance, traditional dance. The grass dancers were our scouts. The traditional dancers were our warriors. And in that, there's history to all these different style of dancers and different things they dance. Like the grass dance, we always say, Gabadabadecha wachipido, which represents dance flexible. And when they say that, it's because they were our scouts, and they would camouflage themselves to break, so that they broke up that profile of a human being when they were out there silhouetted against the horizon, so they didn't look like a human being, and they would use that to kind of be stealthful in the manner in which they went, because their relatives and their tribe depended on the information that they received when they went out there and observed. Because they went out and scouted, they couldn't be seen, heard, smelled, or recognized in any way, so they were very good at what they did. So the grass dancers, they were our scouts. They would come back, give that information to the traditional dancers, the ones with feathers, and they were our warriors to go out and defend or protect the tribal interests. So it's kind of evolvement of that. It's that style and manner in which powwow has evolved. And so in a contemporary time, again, you know, a lot of people talk about powwow and money. You'll never get rich dancing powwow, because we don't have much, and as First Nations people, we're taught with little what we got, we're taught to share it. And so as we do these things, it's not about the money, because we're not capitalistic. It's about the opportunity of counting that coup, winning that championship, and then sharing that in a good way, as we always try to give back to the circle for the sake of others, for the sake of the greater good. And that's everybody that's here. And so that representation of that diversity from many different tribes helps us realize the uniqueness that I talk about is usually through our ceremony or and our language, eh? That's, and so we try to share that with our young people, and so that they can understand identity of who and what they are, looking for the answer to why we are, helps them to understand the importance of this whole aspect of what they refer to as a social gathering, the celebration of life, as powwow. Long ago, they wouldn't have a grand entry. They would just start dancing and the people would come in. But as time has evolved, just to kind of keep things a little bit more coordinated based on the competition and the money that they danced for, they had to get numbers and organize it. So what they did was they followed the rodeo. Eh? They seen the rodeo. And like the royalty, that evolved from the rodeo as well. So the rodeo would have grand entries, so we start having grand entries, start taking numbers, just to make it more efficient, if you will, for lack of a better word. If you notice that the eagle staff is bent, it's a bent stick. What that represents, originally it was a spear. It was a straight spear. They had feathers on it because the warriors would go to war and they'd utilize that spear to defend their tribe. But then they became understanding of how we needed to learn how to get along together. And in our language, we say, Wola Khota, peace, eh? We strive for it. So what they did was they took that spear and they bent it over to represent that we're a peaceful people. We have no want to go and dominate somebody else or utilize our spear in a bad way, eh? So they bent that spear over, and that's where the crooked stick comes from. And then the eagle feathers on there represents the veterans, eh? And again, those brave acts, brave and courageous acts on the battlefield. And so we'd come back and we present, when one of our relatives did a brave and courageous act on the battlefield and it was talked about and proven, if you will, for lack of a better word, they'd present a eagle feather to that staff, and that would represent that family, eh? You know, that's one thing that we do as First Nations people. We're a very humble society or tribal people. And so we always understand that there's something greater than us, eh? It's beyond who and what we are as a human being. As in our language, we say, Huhu Nupa, the two-legged, eh? And we're very inclusive of all of God's creation, the Wamakashka. And what that means is the plants, the animals, the insects, the winged, the four-legged, and the two-legged are all part of that Changleshka, that circle of life. And so initially when we start, before we start any gathering, we usually pray. And so we utilize the pipe in that manner to go to the Creator, because in our way we believe whatever you ask for with the pipe, you will receive, eh? And so we always ask for Wola Khuta, peace amongst us, eh? And all good things in how we do things, not to be upset, not to be mad at anybody or anything, but just to come together in a good way to help one another realize our purpose and our dedication in life in a good way. And you know, some of these characteristics of powwows, we tease lots. And the old people watch, when you're teased, when you're one receiving the teasing, do you have the character and the strength of character to be able to deal with that? Some people don't, and then they get upset. If they get upset, that means they're weak, okay? And so that's a part of our culture. That's a characteristic of our culture. But at the same time, you know, the pipe ceremony is very key. That's always first, okay? So we have it first thing, and then we can get on with our day and do these activities. You know, again, we hold in high regard this eagle spirit, and coming from natural law, we watch the eagle fly. He'll fly so high you can't see him no more. So we, and under natural law, believe the eagle has the ability to take our prayers to the Creator. And in that, when we drop an eagle feather on the ground, it doesn't say that that's a bad thing. What that says is, we utilize those things, and because of the reverence that we pay to that eagle spirit, we'd like to recover it in a good way. Our Mother Earth takes care of us with our medicine, with our food, anything that we need. The Mother Earth looks after us, so she's not dirty, but it's not a bad thing. We're just paying reverence to that eagle spirit because of that feather that fell. And if it's a dancer that uses eagle feathers, then and that will make that dancer even better because he'll pay more attention to his regalia so it doesn't happen again. Make sense?